Hello everyone and welcome to another Gamepad Online interview. Hope you're enjoying the stream so far. As you know, with Gamepad, we break into the live action to talk to video game professionals to find out more about their journey, how they got to where they are, and the work that they do. So, my name is Nigel, for those that don't know yet. I'm the co-founder of MyAmada and organizer of the Gamepad events, and generally in the background while all the thing is going on. But I pop out every so often to talk to people like my guest here. So we're going to get straight into the interview and get some insight from our guest, journalist and games presenter, Shay Thompson. Shay, welcome to the interview space.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to talk about careers and video games.
Cool. I'm definitely excited to hear more about your career. I know some of the story. I might have forgotten some of it. So this is partly for me, just to refresh my memory on who you are and exactly what you do. Also, you keep adding things. You're one of these people that keep adding things. So I just need to catch up on the CV, see what's going on.
Because things happen, I take stuff away, and I'm like, oh, maybe that sounds better.
And you rearrange it. I know. All right, we'll see what the latest edition is. So as usual, you can give us your feedback in the stream chat. If you are watching this later, you can join our Discord if you have questions or insights that you'd like to share with us. Or you can do what a lot of people do and just shout on social media. We are at MyAmada on Twitter, at MyAmadaTees on Instagram. So Shay, like I mentioned, is doing, let me not put that in past tense, like you're still...
is tired. Doing,
yeah, I know. This is your retirement. Is doing a lot of stuff. So she has previously hosted McLaren's Shadowcast and appeared in other McLaren shows on YouTube. Outside of that, she has also hosted panels and podcasts for BAFTA. We're going to touch on that a bit later. And is currently appearing on BBC Sounds podcast, Press X to Continue. And have I missed anything? Anything common?
I think that's everything. I guess one of the other ones is the Glasshouse Games channel
I knew that was part
of. Yeah. To be fair, that's my fault. I don't think I gave you that information, but yeah.
Okay, cool. All right. We've now covered everything that you're currently presently doing. As I like to do in these interviews and any good story, we start at the beginning. So what I'm interested in is what you were doing before you got into the games industry.
Oh my God, so long ago now. I never went to university or anything. Like before games, I was just working any job that I could do, really. I worked in HMV for a long time. That's like the bulk of my kind of employment history. Yeah. So before I was talking about games, I was selling them. Okay. That was pretty cool. And then I worked at Topshop for some time. I was like a stylist for a little bit. And then I worked in the cash office. I don't have very good math skills, though. That's one thing that
that's
I did
a
not.
Bad combination.
Yeah. No math skills, counting money. It's like, no, to be fair, I was quite good at my job. Let me just... I was actually very good in the cash office. I loved it.
I was pushed out.
I was forced out, God damn it. Yeah, that was a pretty cushy job. That big Top Shop in Oxford Circus is no longer there. So rest in... Can I say that?
We're keeping this family friendly. I'm going to beat that.
Okay. I'm so sorry.
Everyone watching, you didn't hear that.
You didn't hear that. That was nothing.
She said peace.
Peace. that pretty much covers it. Before games, it was, HMV, Topshop, and then like just loads of random jobs that I could get my hands on. So, I remember like, what else I did? I think my last job before I was in the games industry, I was doing finance for a company that I'm pretty sure was a pyramid scheme. And then I left like after a couple of months because I was like, I don't want this on my conscience.
So. No, a good decision.
Right? Morally, pretty good.
Yeah. You want to be able to sleep at night.
Yeah, you know, I value my sleep.
Hmm. So then, all right, because it sounds like you were making sort of the, almost like the retail circuit, but then at what point was there a decision that I'm going to now make my way into games?
Conscious decision. I think, like, in the back of my mind, if someone had asked me, you know, what's your dream job? This is what I would have described. But at the time, it was so, like, inconceivable. Like, I couldn't figure out how to make it happen. And we'll get onto this later on in terms of advice that's usually given for this sort of thing is, oh, you know, just do stuff on your own. That was always what people would say is, you know, make a YouTube channel, do this, do stuff off of your own back. And while that does work, and that works for some people, I mean, it was something that I hadn't really tried. So I think I quit my job at Topshop and I just made a bunch of like really terrible YouTube videos. And they were crunchy. That was I think as close as I got to saying, right, okay, this is how I want to make a career out of this, you know, is those kind of terrible videos I made.
Okay. Wow. And but, so then where did the, from making those videos into a job, into a role, into an opportunity, mm-hmm. what was that bridge like?
What happened?
So
I happen to be friends with someone who's quite prominent in the games industry, and she, like, we were friends before she like entered the games industry. We actually met through working at HMV, and as like, you know, her star continued to rise within the games industry, and she passed my YouTube channel along to a games media broadcast agency, which at the time I was like, that's a thing?
Yeah, I was just about to say that.
I was like, that's a thing? There's an agency dedicated to making like media and it's like broadcast media about video games? I thought those things kind of died out. Like, you know, so we don't really see like prominent games media, because in my mind I was like, oh, just on TV. But that wasn't really a thing at the time. So yeah, so when it was passed along, they contacted me and said, you know, we're casting for a new show, would love you to like try out to be our host. And you know, that's like dream territory, dream job territory right there. But at the time I felt so, you know, when people are like fake it until you make it, I didn't even have that kind of fake confidence. I didn't even have that. So I was just like, no, but do you have anything else that I could do in the sort of admin?
No to the opportunity.
Saying no seems really weird. It's more that like I said, do you have anything else for someone as green as me? And so I took on a position as a runner, and a runner is somebody who on shoots and at like in an office, they're like the bottom of the food chain. Basically, you're getting teas, coffees, you're booking people's travel. The logic at the time was, if I don't feel confident enough to be in front of the camera, then I can like learn all of the ropes being behind the camera, get comfortable being in that environment, and then work my way up. That was my logic at the time.
Okay. That is some logic.
Some logic, yeah. Some would question the efficacy of it.
Yeah,
but,
some may.
Some would.
All right, so you're kind of foot in the door somewhat. You had your foot in, you took it out, you half put it back in. At this point, what did your parents or family think about your moves into the video games? Because, and the reason I always like to bring this up is just working with young people, well, to be honest, me, I had to have that conversation, but also working with young people, I know that sometimes those from sort of underrepresented backgrounds don't always get the support from family that you might expect or you might want. So for you, what was that? Was there a conversation? What was that like?
For a lot of sort of like, you know, African and Caribbean kids, like your parents came to this country, they worked their off to like, you know, make a life. So it's like, you think you're going to go and do something creative over my dead body? Like, it's usually what the answer is. But my parents and my mum in particular, she like, I guess I was a weird kid by a lot of like Ghanaian standards. So she was just like, I have like tattoos and stuff. I think when I came home with like my third tattoo, she was just like, oh, this kid is so weird. So I think in her mind, she just sort of accepted it. And like, I was always involved in like a lot of creative stuff growing up anyway. I had the academic stuff, but I did have the creative stuff. And she actually just encouraged me to do anything. She was like, as long as you've got an interest in something, I will support you doing that. So when I said, like, look, I want to actually try and do this, like, properly as a career, she was like, you know, if as long as you can pay your bills, as long as you're happy, as long as you've got food in your belly and a roof over your head, I'm happy to support you. And, you know, so, like, in that sense, I've been really fortunate. I didn't have that to sort of fight against. So I'm, you know, I thank my lucky stars every single day.
Yeah, that's really good. I think, because I guess it does come from that place, like you say, as long as you can cover yourself and you're paying your way, then that's I guess all they want. And it's that contrasted with this idea of games as there's no money here. So why would you do that? But it's good that you had that kind of backing.
Absolutely. And yeah, like I said, I was really fortunate. And like, I don't know, it's tricky because I'm sometimes quite down on myself where I say, like, you know, I was quite lucky, and I do think luck factors into it, but I do think you manufacture your own luck at times, and you engineer your own luck. And so, you know, you can make the most of opportunities at the best of times.
And yeah, like, it's funny. The number of people that have come, I should start counting, the number of people that come and said they're lucky, but then I have to counter and said, because you, even though, I mean, I haven't seen these YouTube videos, so I'll take your word that they were terrible or whatever the word you used was, but you did something, and it's that thing that enables someone to say, hey, look at this, and give you that opportunity that you turned down, but, you know, we'll kind of come to that. But you got the opportunity because you did something. So when people say they're lucky, you can kind of trace it down to, I did something.
Yeah.
And that's what kind of got the opportunity.
Exactly. It's like, you know, I don't really do manual labor, but it's like, you know, if you've got a flint and a stone, I'm like,
I know what you're talking about right now.
No, yeah, so. don't take me camping because, ooh, I'll be looking at these things like, what? No. But, you know, it's like that spark that is initially made and then it kind of becomes its own fire. There's a metaphor in there that I'm trying to make. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not the person to ask about that because I will stay at home. We're not even going to talk about camping. I've had these discussions. I don't understand why you'd live outside when we build houses. Anyway, that's not why we're here. We're not here to talk about camping.
That could be its own focus. I got some thoughts.
So to the stuff that you do, what do you do? What can you explain? And why I wanted to say this is because we live in a time where having an opinion on games and putting it out is fairly easy. So what I'm interested in is, what do you do for people who aren't in your position? And what's the line between sort of me just jumping on Twitter and giving my opinion or YouTube and someone who's doing it professionally as a job?
Absolutely. Like, I think that's a really good question because people like me and then, you know, down the line, like content creators and stuff, we all exist in this very gray area where the internet is so great that everyone can do anything. You can be anything you want on the internet. But the difference is like, I don't know, I think is maybe just external validation. Maybe that's the difference because, you know, there are loads of critics who are, you know, just amazing, incredible minds, but they're not even in the top 10 names when you see like people talking about critics online on social media. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, even that validation thing is a very, very gray area. So what I describe what I do is, before I used to be quite, again, very, very self-deprecating. I'd say, oh, you know, like all I do is I show up, I talk about video games, they tell me to stop filming, I go home. And it's like, no, it actually is quite difficult to have an opinion on a piece of media and be able to articulate it well and articulate it on camera. Those are like the fundamental parts of my job. And that's actually not easy to do. It looks very easy. I think if it looks easy, then that person's doing their job very effectively. But it's actually not that easy. And there are elements of it that I think I do better at, and there are elements that I do worse at. Like, for example, I don't necessarily think I'm a good live broadcaster because I don't know what it is. Like, when the cameras go live, like in a pre-recorded session, I'm like, oh my God, amazing. This is like breathing for me. There's something about knowing that it's live and knowing that there are no do-overs that just turns me into a chicken. And I've been doing this for like a couple of years now. So it's like, you know, it really varies. And, you know, you ask a dozen broadcasters and they'll have like different thoughts and different strengths and weaknesses. But like I said, I think those are the core parts, is like knowing what you're saying about this piece of media. Sometimes you're going to have opinions that are similar to other people's, and generally that's a good thing. But I think I think a good stroke of genius is like, you don't always have to be like groundbreaking or innovative with everything that you do, but stopping people in their tracks and making them like shift their perspective, or maybe make them consider a new perspective, I think is the mark of like, you know, really being effective as a critic, as a journalist, as a presenter, I think anyway.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, because so particularly with social media, you can, so obviously like the articulate thing kind of sometimes goes out the window with social media, but I think specifically the seeing another perspective, and a lot of the times that I see kind of, you know, it tends to be outrage, but just conversations on Twitter, I see a lot of people unable to take themselves out of their own perspective and recognize that there are other perspectives that you might not agree with, but are still valid.
Yeah, exactly.
Being able to do that part is actually quite beneficial and useful.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And that's useful like across your life as well, not just for something like this. It's, but yeah. And also like, I think without, you know, taking up too much time, but I think a very good example of this is like Cyberpunk. When that came out, a lot of the coverage was about how glitchy it was, and, you know, there were loads of bugs, there's half the game missing, things like that. I played through the entirety of Cyberpunk, and when I finished the game, it literally blue screened my PC. That's how I finished the game. But that's not the stuff that stays with me. The stuff that stays with me is the really poor handling of the Haitian characters, the really poor trans representation. It's fumbling of like, you know, just very serious topics that could have been broached in a very like thoughtful and meaningful way. That's the stuff that stays with me. And that's the stuff that I want to see people talking about, not just like, you know, bugs and is it fun and stuff, you know? So
yeah,
things like that.
Beneath the surface.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And sort of looking back to the jobs you had previously, is there anything that you felt you've kind of taken, any experiences or skills that you've taken from the completely unrelated areas into what you do now?
Yeah. As someone who worked a lot of retail, like even like before HMV, there were other jobs I worked. You have to be patient as a customer service provider. And so I'm pretty patient when it comes to a lot of things, which has helped immensely. You know, if shoots aren't going well because of tech issues, there's no reason to like kind of blow up and be like, why is this taking too long? And it's funny because like you'll have like, you know, runners and like directors and producers come up to you like, oh my God, I'm so sorry, this is taking too long. I'm like, no, I've had like customers make me wait on them basically hand and foot for like half an hour. Like this is not the same thing. And then also like with jobs, I know this wasn't really your question, but jobs that are kind of similar have helped me. Like every job I do now is just like bettering myself for the next one. Like when I was a streamer for Xbox, that did give me like more comfort in like doing live stuff, not massively, but even just being able to handle trolls a lot easier now, because that's unfortunately part and parcel of this job at times. So a lot of, you know, nonsense that comes in my like mentions, I just look at it with glazed eyes. I'm like, okay. I mean, that's a sort of bad thing that I've gotten so used to it, but you do develop this thick skin, and that does help. Because with this job, I always say presenting is like dancing the very fine line between vulnerability and narcissism. You don't want to you don't want to go too far into one or the other. It is just kind of like maintaining that line. And, you know, it is vulnerable because you are presenting a very authentic version of yourself, even if that is editorialized to one degree or another, to an audience who don't know you, but you have to make them feel like you do. You want to make them feel comfortable and stuff. So it's like, you know, you're bearing your soul in one way and your opinions and thoughts. So just being able to handle that. And again, that's where the customer service stuff comes into it, because you get a lot of nonsense thrown your way, like especially if you work at big flagship stores and stuff. Like,
I can imagine.
Yeah. So again, that sort of helped with that too.
Okay. Cool. So yeah, it's kind of prepare each step, like you say, preparing you for the next one.
Mm.
So with that in mind, in terms of like taking those steps and thinking to like a younger version of yourself or just young people in general who might look at what you're doing or what someone else in the industry is doing and say like, you know, I want to kind of get to that. Like, what would be your advice for someone who's starting out in the industry to take that first step or whatever number mm-hmm. steps they're on? What would you say to them?
Yeah, I mean, there's the kind of classic advice that's given out for this sort of thing, which is, you know, be bold, make your own content and stuff. But that stuff is really intangible. That, you know, if you do want to be a genuine critic of games and not just someone who just spouts opinions on social media, and you want to do that on video or podcasts or writing, I think what you should be doing is sitting with yourself and how you engage media, not just games, but media as a whole. And that will really help like open up your sort of critical mind. I think games really, more than any other art form or medium, kind of the way we talk about them, we talk about them like we talk about toys. So it's like, is it fun? Does the mechanics bring us joy? Like, is it glitchy? Is it? And it's like, yeah, that stuff, you know, it sometimes impedes on your experience of the game. But more importantly, like, these are pieces of art, and we should be talking about what it makes us feel. You know, what's the knock-on effect on this piece of media, on the industry, on the world? Like, what's it going to be 10, 20, 30 years from now? That's how we should be thinking about things. So it's challenging yourself to, yeah, kind of sit with these pieces of media more than just like toys that you consume like you would, you know, I don't know, some Amiibo figurine or something like that, you know?
They look fun too, to be fair.
They do. I've got a couple. That's actually why it's like it's right in my eye line.
We're gonna get to find out what else is in your room by what you reference later on. We'll build up that picture. But no, look, that is good advice. I think, like, and even for me, when I go into schools and speak to young people and I say, you know, I do this event and it's in games and, oh yeah, I play games. Usually it's the, say, like Roblox, Fortnite, Call of Duty, FIFA and all that. And I'm always of a mind to say, kind of look beyond that. Like if you're saying you want to get into the industry, like look beyond that and try and like I said before, so take yourself out of your own perspective. Mm. That's fine that you like those games, but try and see what else is there and why. Even for the ones you do like, why do you like them? If you don't like them, why don't you like them?
Mm.
And try and get that kind of mindset going.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. Play games you don't like. That I actually find it a challenge to talk about games that I feel like meh about. Like games that I love, obviously I know why I love them. Games that I don't like, and that's the challenge for a lot of people, is playing stuff because they're like, I don't like this, why would I want to play it? But I'm like, you'll surprise yourself. I really surprised myself with Cyberpunk because I don't even say I hate that game. I dislike that game because hating it means that I think about it all the time, which I don't. but yeah, I mean, it gave me a new set of tools with which to describe, you know, games that I don't like. And yeah, just like really pushing myself. Why don't I like this? What's so bad about it? Like, you know, really asking yourself those questions. What, like, you know, and with the games that I feel like kind of tepid about, it's like, you know, what makes me feel so tepid about this? You know, what's, again, challenging myself, pushing myself forward. I think if it is available to you, I'd say absolutely do those two things. Play stuff that you feel all right about, or you just straight up dislike. And give you lots to like speak and think about, for sure.
Yeah, cool. All right, there you go. So people listening, you've got that advice. Go forth and play some games. Okay, so the advice you gave is really good. So I want to kind of talk about something related to it with, well, I was going to say with young people, but I also felt this just as recently as last year. But this idea of imposter syndrome for people, and it's something that I think we've previously spoken about. Like I say, it's something that has been on my mind like this year. So as you've been on this journey, sort of into the industry, getting these roles with like big organizations, what was the point where you felt you made it, like you are now in the industry? Hopefully it isn't just right now, but
can you imagine today? Yeah, no, I mean, it's kind of twofold because like my imposter syndrome has always been there. Like the reason why I turned down my first ever position, like the hosting role, like I said, it wasn't even a position. It was the opportunity to test screen for it. That's because I felt like I wasn't good enough, you know? Yeah. That's why I did it. So I've always had like the imposter syndrome. I think the point where I felt like, oh, okay, I've made it, as it were, I think is maybe when I got the call to do the McLaren work. Because I feel like it's not good karma to like badmouth your employers, but they were terrible to me. but I mean, the short story rather is that the company I was working for at the time, they were working with McLaren. They stopped working with McLaren, and then a new company that took over, they approached me to host the Shadowcast show and like other bits of content for them. And it was at that point, like when I went to go and do the screen test, that whole story, which I don't know how much time we have, I can just launch into the short one, I guess.
Cool.
Which is, they called me up. They were like, oh, you know, we think you'd be a really great fit for this. And I was like, oh, I'm about to be in Ghana for like 2 weeks. It wasn't even like a holiday. I was actually going for like a pretty serious family thing. I was like, I can't really move this trip. And so what they did was they moved the entire project. Oh my God, I can't believe that just happened. Moved my mic. They moved the entire project and I went away. I came back and then I screen tested for it. So I didn't even have the job. I screen tested for it. And when I was sat, funny enough, I was wearing this exact turtleneck. Bit of a link there.
Yeah.
So I screen tested for it. I read the first line off of the auto cue and he was like, that's the one. Like, and it was at that moment. Yeah. So I was just like, okay. So clearly I have a skill because it's not just me, you know, doing stuff to an audience of one or doing stuff in my bedroom. This is like a legit company. This is, you know, these are legit people in this industry who recognize my talent. And it's like, that's when a kind of light bulb went off and I was like, oh, this is real. This is real, you know. I'm in this now, and that's from that moment on, you know. And like, the imposter syndrome stuff does come up for me like a lot, like all the time. And there are times where I'm like, oof, I'm a bad bee, no one can touch me. Like, but a lot of the time it is just, you know, am I good enough to be working on this project? And I have to remind myself like of those kind of moments that I, you know, sometimes forget about when it's convenient.
So, yeah, no, I feel the same. And isn't it strange how, because what you're essentially describing is the external validation from someone else. But this is what I've kind of had on my mind like over the past year and you know, what a year, is that you're kind of external validation for people who can't do what you're doing. Because that's the reason you're there. You're there because whatever the role is, there's no one else that can do it.
Yeah.
And then you're sort of questioning yourself because you've got the talent. So I just find that's weird because I totally feel you on the idea of like, it is what I'm doing good enough and how will you know? And it's a hard thing to kind of wrestle with, I think, for me, like, especially in this year that it's
been. Because like you can't always get external validation for a lot of the work that, you know, it's not really applicable. Who else is going to validate you, you know? So it's not something you can just wait around for. What I will say about that is I think, and I'm looking at this objectively as someone who's like a bit older from where I was previously. I mean, that's how the passage of time works.
I don't remember much about time, but I remember that.
I think that's the biggest thing. But like, yeah, looking back on it, I think the reason why I struggled with imposter syndrome so much is because I was like constantly underestimated and like undermined and just almost like thrown away, basically. So it's like, yeah, you know, it's easy to say you shouldn't rely on external validation. But I think when you're constantly told that you know, it's abnormal for you to be in a certain place or in a certain position and stuff. That stuff does start to chip away at you a little bit. Yeah, and so of course, getting what you need is like, it's hard. But I think, and you know, not to turn this back on you, but I think like the work you're doing is so important and it touches so many people's lives. Like whether or not you always see that, it does. And that's what you have to remember is, you know, only you can do what you do. No one else can. So that's something like, it's cheesy, it's corny, but you do have to really internalize that. Like, and for everyone listening, I think it is something you really need to take to heart because, you know, there's only one you. As corny as it is, true.
That is corny, but I'm going to clip that and use that for my daily affirmations. So like, there is only one you.
That's true. Unless you're a twin or a triplet, then I'm like, sorry.
Yeah, there's some disappointed twins.
Sorry. So, yeah, they're just like, I guess I'm not. But for everyone else.
Yeah, everyone else, you're good.
You're good.
Cool. So you spoke about McLaren, that being sort of a big name, and as I mentioned early on, you've worked with some big names, and to be fair, I think this applies to McLaren as well, but particularly like BAFTA and the BBC. So these aren't necessarily places like gamers, he says like quote unquote gamers, would go to for gaming news. What do you think is the value for those kind of outlets and the work you do with them?
That's a very good question, actually. I don't think anyone's ever asked me that question. I think, so I'm like, shouts to you, that's good.
Well, it's only me.
only you can ask a question like that, so that's good. I think about, so going through each of them, actually, with McLaren, what was particularly interesting is that, like, I had a very tenuous link to Formula One. Like, it was something I watched very casually beforehand in, like, racing sims. I liked the really arcadey ones, not really, like, the sort of super technical ones. But it did open up this world for me, like back into Formula One proper and racing sims. And then what it also did was help bring people like me who have this tenuous link. Obviously you've got like your hardcore fans, but bringing a new audience to this world that is very deeply entrenched in itself. That was the value I saw. And it did help to simplify a lot of terms. I was almost like the, I'm trying to think of like a good phrase for this is, you know, people who are just like Formula One for dummies. I was like the kind of poster child for that. And so that was the value I saw in that project. With BAFTA, and I guess by extension the BBC as well, is, you know, actually, that's a lie. Those are quite different. Is BAFTA is a very obviously prestigious organization, and it is just lending credence and like actually giving recognition to how incredibly like diverse and beautiful and innovative the world of gaming is. And like, you know, again, just going beyond the surface, no longer just talking about them as games, as, you know, fun pieces of media, as like actual art, and delving into how these things get made, you know, talking to actors who work on games, you know, talking to people who do lighting and cinematography in games. Like, you know, we don't really get to see behind the curtain with video games like we do for music, TV and film. So being able to kind of provide that insight into gaming through BAFTA is like just endlessly, yeah, that's all I kind of want from my career, is being able to do stuff like that. And with the BBC is, you know, games are this really big phenomenon, especially for people like us who are entrenched in this world. You know, we know how much games make, if you know that's the angle you want to look at it as. You know, we know it's that it's a lot, billions, like, yeah. And but sure. It's still yeah, but it is still treated like this kind of niche hobby that only like white guys living in their parents' basements do. And that's not the case. But the value I see in doing work with the BBC is like, you've got this very big mainstream audience, and being able to, it's a challenge for me in and of itself, is being able to take very complex things, or things that we don't see as complex, but other people see as complex, and really simplifying it down, but retaining like the core like messaging of it and communicating that to a mainstream audience, so they too can see the value of games, but also, you know, invite them into this world that is really, really exciting and really innovative in so many ways, and get them, yeah, bring them in on the fun, because there is a lot of fun to be had, and bring them in on like the really serious stories that are being told. And so that's sort of, yeah, the value I see in working with the BBC. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, no, it does answer the question, and it just makes you think about, like, there are different ways to talk about games. And I know sometimes when games like kind of reach the BBC, obviously not everything in games reaches the level of BBC, but what does has the ability to, like you say, sort of explain the medium, the industry, the culture, but then also potentially sort of pull people in to say, oh, that thing is interesting. That's not necessarily all I thought of about video games. Let me find out some more. And I feel there's like that kind of ability that that it has.
Yeah, totally. And like, you know, just thinking of like an actual example is I was asked to do a BBC a PS5 review for BBC Newsround. And if I was doing a review for, you know, something like IGN or I'm trying to think of another outlet. I don't know, Eurogamer or something. GameSpot. Yeah. Like those reviews would have been very, very different. But it's, again, it's just thinking of a way to communicate, you know, why people should care about the PS5 had they not previously. And, you know, is it value for money? All these sorts of things. So, yeah, you know, really playing with how we kind of communicate this amazing medium, the mainstream.
Cool. Okay. All right. So staying on the topic of media and sort of how we communicate this industry, media discourse is something that I have been more exposed to. So games media discourse, something I've been more exposed to since, you know, starting Gamepad, particularly since doing all the online activities that we started since the pandemic. It's not all good. it's I don't know if you noticed that. And
a thing or two, you know.
Yeah, there's a couple problematic areas, but so I'll start with the how it affects your job, and I kind of touched on it earlier. But how do you operate in this world where everyone can give their opinion, and their opinion is right and you're wrong, and here's why you're wrong? Like, how do you like engage with people on that level?
One of the things I think about is, you know, like when we were in primary school and they tell you that, you know, everyone, your opinion is valid. I wish they hadn't done that. I wish they'd said, actually, some of your opinions are bad because they're rooted in bias and ignorance and straight up hatred and just being wrong. And that's okay. That is, it's actually fine for your opinion to be bad and incorrect. And it doesn't mean you're a bad person. It does mean that you're critical mind is not as sharp as you think it is. is what I wish had been said instead. I think it's an interesting thing, because I do think that, you know, games are great compared to, you know, any other medium like film, TV, because you bring such a personal experience to them. So, you know, your life has so many different layers in it, and that's the experience, and that's what you bring to whatever game you play. But I think, and that's the biggest thing, is if your opinion is rooted in like bigotry or hatred or like extreme bias, I'm just like, that's not actually a proper opinion. That's just, you know, that's just espousing really terrible thoughts for nothing. Like, I think I said this earlier on, if your thoughts are like, it's not necessarily that everything has to be, you know, monolithic, every opinion has to exist in this hegemony, but if it's not like I said, making people change their perspective, if it's not like genuinely innovative or groundbreaking, then I'm like, and to be fair, not everything has to be those things, but
yeah.
I keep going back to the well of cyberpunk, the very murky brown well of cyberpunk. It's because, like I said, a lot of people are just like, oh my God, they rushed this, especially when more and more things came out about the game. They were like, oh, just, you know, you had people like defending them, you know, just very openly and throwing all caution to the wind. And then you had people who were like, yeah, like all these bugs, that's how you know it's a terrible game. But then, you know, all the buried lead or lead was that actually there are some really harmful depictions in this game, and that's not being spoken about by a lot of people, and that's a problem. That's actually a problem, and that goes back to how we review games. It goes back to how we talk about them. We talk about them as toys, as like fundamental entertainment pieces. Entertainment being like, you know, products. That's the word I was looking for, as products. And it's like industry people get really annoyed when we have the conversation about whether or not games are art. The reason why we keep having to have this conversation is because we're having this conversation by ourselves or having this conversation in the industry. You need to continue having that conversation outwardly for it to actually stick and make a difference. First of all, that's just a quick industry run. That's over. But yeah, once that changes, once we actually start reviewing stuff, and this is on people who work at big outlets, small outlets, once we start actually, you know, discussing these things as art, as like, you know, art pieces that are worthy of proper critique, of like preservation, things like that, that's when I think we'll kind of have this shift. Or if we blow up the internet, one or the other.
Yeah, that last one probably not going to happen. But so we might.
One can hope, though.
But yeah, I know. Yeah, it is really interesting. I like what you said about sort of the way games are spoken about like sort of these toys or these entertainment products. I mean, which, you know, obviously they are entertaining and they are that, but there's more to it, and I find it's just my opinion, but there's also, on top of what you said, there's also like a sense of entitlement among games, which kind of shapes the way people respond to certain things. So if a game is delayed or it doesn't have the specific feature that you wanted, or you know, things that, or the story didn't go in a direction that it specifically wanted, then that becomes a problem, where it doesn't need to be. It's about, again, you talk about perspectives, about, you know, here's a perspective that is offered. You don't have to like it. Like, no one's forcing you into it. But it's still okay to not like it, just the way you talk about it. And that's what I've seen in some of the Discord, is that the way people are speaking about games and the people that make them. So I'm trying hard not to bring up Last of Us, but I'll just say this, largely in the Last of Us, just the way, like, you know, you don't have to like that experience. I personally did. I thought it was great. And when you talk about games as art and games as a product that can sort of challenge your perspective, it certainly did that for me, because I felt a certain way about some of the characters and that changed by the end.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that, I think that is one of the games that, probably the only game where there were certain points, or a couple of points in particular, where I did not want to do what the game was asking me to do. But I like that, because it's like, I don't like what this character is doing. I don't want to, but I have to, because that's the experience that I bought into. But that's me. I like that. You don't have to like that. But then it's kind of the, on top of that, is that I don't like that. Therefore, the person that made it is less than.
It's
not valid. Is all that. And that's a weird kind of thing that I've noticed over the past year, and in particular, I've been paying attention. So you've been sort of in it longer, and then no more sort of to that point.
No, I think that's a really good example, though. Like, I mean, The Last of Us Part 2 is my favorite thing that I played last year, and yeah, I had those. I mean, there are games that I stopped playing because I'm like, I hate this, or because this is a bad game. But there are moments where I stopped playing that because I was like, I don't know if I can do what this game wants me to do. And that as an experience is so deeply profound. And you don't get that in other like media formats. You don't get, I mean, yeah, you can stop watching something because you don't like it. But like, well, to actively,
you have to,
that's your enjoyment, is playing it. So to have that, I think, is just really magical. And, you know, for people to be like, well, I don't like this. And again, because they're not forcing themselves to go deeper, they're just like, oh, this thing that happened to this character, I don't like it. So that means you're a terrible person. I'm like, that I think that says so much about your like fundamental, just like shallow absorption of media. Do you know what I mean? Like, if that is truly where the buck started and stopped with you when it came to this specific game, that I mean, sorry. I think it sounds quite elitist, but it does make me question how like intelligent you are, and like how much you think about things, how introspective you are, because that for me is just such a shallow way to engage with something that is so much richer than that, you know?
Yeah.
And yeah, it's sad to say it, but it's quite common, which is the really depressing part.
Yeah, I've noticed. So that's why, like, so when I don't know if this is a question or just me wanting to get that out, but that's why I was thinking for you as someone in the media, where you have to operate in this, you have to, like I say, give that opinion, that critique to someone who's, you know, some might have already made up their mind, or because you've given your view, that means you are XYZ type of person. It's really difficult. And I mean, sort of, this is kind of, I guess, outside of scope for this, but in terms of the people who make the games, then having to also operate within that, I imagine it would shape how they operate to a certain extent, or at least on a personal level, how they feel about the work they're doing. But yeah, it's a...
Yeah, it's a sad thing, because, like, you know, if you are proud of, you know, making a game like that, even though it was under like very questionable like conditions, that's one part of it. But, you know, you're obviously enthusiastic to talk about your work, and then to have such a vocal, I won't even say minority, but a vocal audience saying these awful things at you, I think is just like, it's scary in a way, because I worry that could stifle creativity. It could stifle, you know, people touching on various themes in their games and going for the easy option that isn't going to rock the boat. And I don't want to live in a world like that. Truly, I do not. Yeah. And I guess, like, relating it back to what I do, I mean, even for like harmless opinions that I've had, like on the Press X to Continue podcast, we, you know, we routinely put stuff out, and like we put up a poll the other day about like best racing game of all time, and it was a very jovial conversation. I wasn't part of like the first part, so what they did was they had a bunch of games that they had in mind, and they whittled it down to this list. And when they put the poll out, I think what was on it, it was like Outrun, Mario Kart 8, Mario Kart 64, and something else, maybe Forza Horizon 4, something like that.
Okay.
And you had no Gran Turismo. That was
I'm not offended by that, but I imagine some people.
That was that was a repeated comment. No Gran Turismo, no Burnout, no all these other games. I mean, the only correct answer is Mario Kart Double Dash, but anyway.
Okay.
It's a pretty solid choice. But yeah, you had people going, this list is a pile of poo, you call yourself critics. You know, how dare you? Like, have you never played a racing game in your life? All this other stuff. I'm like, relax. More than any other medium, it feels like, anyway, is like, if you like critique a certain game, gamers are so territorial and take stuff for so personally. It's like you're calling them their ancestors, their lineage. You're calling all of them.
All your people.
Like, all your people, all of them are terrible, and you deserve to rot in hell for the rest of time. Like, that's what they think you're saying. And I'm just like, what? How did we get here? Like, is it that deep?
Apparently. Having said that, sometimes I do go to videos just for the comments. I'm just being honest. Like, so it's just, it can be entertaining. But, it's an issue. So,
yeah. I mean, like I said, I've sort of learned to shrug stuff off. Like, I will, you know, do a job, put the opinion out there, and I'm like, it's out there. I'm not thinking about it anymore now. And that's it. Okay. So.
Fair enough. All right, let me before we wrap, let me ask maybe something a bit more positive, and just looking to like the future of the industry. And I know in terms of like some of the stuff that we do with Gamepad, about us talking about like young people and people from underrepresented backgrounds, but just for, like, for anyone who wants to get in the industry, like, what do you think we can do to kind of increase the access for those that do want to offer their voice or their skills to this industry?
Well, and I think it's starting to happen, is more internships that are paid, more placements that are paid, and most importantly, I found anyway, as someone who didn't go to university, not having that as a boundary, like, you know, just letting people, regardless of their skill level, use the placement, use the internship to gain experience, because experience is the biggest thing, right? It doesn't really matter about like what it, like, you know, what degree you have or don't have. It's, you know, like I said, it's that fundamental part of having the critical thought and being able to articulate and being able to articulate it on camera or, you know, in your medium of choice. And so it's, you know, giving people the platform to do that, I think, is quite a big thing for people, because then you can leverage that for so many other things. I've used some very tenuous things to the leverage stuff. So, you know, I think that's the biggest part, is giving people the opportunity to gain tangible experience. And then also, like, more mentorship schemes. Like, everyone benefits from mentorship. I'm trying to get a mentor right now, you know? And so just, you know, if it's that that you need, like, I think more people need to, like, ready themselves. I guess myself included. I because I'm like, oh, imposter syndrome. I'm like, do I have what it takes to be a mentor? But, you know, if that is genuinely something that you think I could help with, I'd be happy to help out. And I'm sure a lot of other people, like, who are in similar roles would be happy to, because I think the general consensus is that people want this industry to change. So I'm hoping that's the case.
I think so, yeah.
And yeah, we can do tangible things, just not lip service, not performative actions, like actual things that are going to make a difference. And I think for me anyway, those are the two biggest parts.
Cool. Mm-hmm. I like both of them. Okay. And my last question is, what are you, because we're now in a new generation of consoles, so what are you most looking forward to in this coming, what is now, next generation? Could be a game.
Oh, that's a very good question. Or... yeah, I think it's probably more titles than tech stuff, because okay. I almost like a technophobe at this point. But you know, it's not even a new game that I'm looking forward to, although Deathloop does look pretty cool. I think that's one of the games recently that I've looked at. I'm like, that's like my jam. Mm. But I suppose I want to see an actual remaster of SSX3, first of all. Give me that.
Oh, wow.
The best sports game ever. Okay. And that is an opinion I'm putting out there, that is correct. SSX3 is the best sports game ever. I want a remaster of that. And I'm really looking forward to the Mass Effect Legendary Edition. Mass Effect is one of my favorite games. It's, you know, it's gotten me through some really tough times, but also, like, it's just so comforting to me and has helped me kind of, you know, develop my critical voice and stuff. And so I'm so excited to revisit that world and those characters and that gameplay, especially Mass Effect 2. So that's what I'm looking forward to.
Cool. I like that. All right. I lied. So my last question, actual last question, is where can people find you online?
Where can people find me on the internet? So on Twitter, I am @moods_JPG. There's a common thread with my social media. My Instagram is @moods.gif. And then Glasshouse Games is, like, probably the channel to find me on most regularly. That's where we do a lot of, like, long form content. You can also, like, consume it as podcasts on your favorite podcast app. We stream on Twitch as well @GHG Show. We were just playing, the co-op game It Takes Two, which is a very interesting game, very, very polarizing aspects of that game, but it is enjoyable. So we're having a lot of fun playing that. And yeah, we've put out, like, some really cool videos that I'm quite pleased with. One in particular, if you have enjoyed me banging on about Cyberpunk so much, we did, like, a full-on, like, review. And then we also did, like, a timeline of, like, every news article that came around in and around the time, or since it was announced and then all the way up to its release. So if that's something you're interested in seeing my hot takes on, those are two pretty cool videos.
Okay. Talk about long form, because that is a lot.
that's a lot.
Yeah.
There's a lot to cover. Cool.
Okay. All right. Well, yeah, we'll add those links to the video description so people can check that out and see more about your, see more of your work. So yeah, Shay, thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me. This was great. It was great catching up. It was also great talking about my story because, like, yeah, I don't really talk about it that often. I don't know if it's that interesting, but...
Breaking news. No, it's really interesting. I was riveted, so...
That's all I want to hear, you know? So thank you.
That's cool. Hopefully people watching this are also as riveted. And, let us know what you think in the comments. Keep in mind what we just said about Discord. But, yeah, let us know your thoughts in the comments. You can join our Discord. We're on social media as well. We are MyMadder on Twitter or MyMadderTees on Instagram. So that has been our interview. we do interviews like this with different video game professionals to get an idea of their journey into the industry and the work they're doing now. We work with young people and those who aspire to be sort of video game professionals. So it's about giving an insight into sort of career paths that people might want to pursue. So you can join us for that. Join us for our next GamePad event in summer. And we also have a podcast, Story X Story, where we talk about stories across pop culture, including video games, but also anime, films, and we do sort of different interviews. So we talk a lot, basically, myself and GamePad host Tazzy. So I'll put that link in the description as well, so you can check that out too. Other than that, that has been our interview for today. Hope you've enjoyed it, and we hope to see you next time at a future event, interview, panel, whatever we do. So until next time, take care, everyone. Hey there, I'm Nigel from My Matter. Thanks for watching our video. Don't forget to subscribe and check out the other great videos we have on the channel. You can also join the GamePad Discord and check out the next event at gamepad.events. We'll see you soon.